Bienvenido, a continuer historias de terror. There are stories that people tell late at night, whispers of strange things that lurk in the dark. As a historian, I never believed in such things, until I found myself face to face with the ghost of the royal mansion. Even now, when I think back to that night, a cold shiver runs down my spine, and I can still hear the slow, deliberate knock at the door. I was never meant to be there. The royal mansion, known as Briarwood Hall, was long abandoned, a relic of a forgotten time. Its grand halls had once hosted kings and queens, but now it stood in disrepair, looming over the surrounding countryside like a shadow. They said it was haunted, of course. Every old building seems to have its legends, but this one felt different. There was something about the mansion, something that made the air feel heavier when you approached it, as if the house itself was watching you. I had been sent to Briarwood Hall on assignment. A simple task, to document the mansion's history for a local project. Nothing more. I arrived just before sunset, the sun casting a golden glow over the crumbling stone walls. The front doors, massive and made of ancient oak, were still intact, standing tall and foreboding at the entrance. I hesitated as I reached for the brass handle, my heart suddenly pounding for reasons I couldn't explain. The inside was dark, colder than I had expected. Dust covered every surface, and the silence was oppressive, pressing in on me from all sides. I told myself it was just a house. I had been in dozens of places like this, empty, old, abandoned. But there was a stillness here that unsettled me. I could feel it in my bones. I moved from room to room, my footsteps echoing through the vast, empty halls. Faded portraits of royals long dead stared down at me from the walls, their eyes seeming to follow my every move. The only sound was the soft creak of the floorboards beneath my feet. The sun was setting fast, and shadows began to stretch across the rooms, making everything feel distorted, unnatural. As I made my way down the grand staircase, heading toward the main hall, I heard it for the first time, a knock. It was faint, almost imperceptible, but unmistakable. A slow, deliberate knock coming from the front door. I froze, my heart leaping into my throat. Who could be out there at this hour? The mansion was miles from any town, and no one knew I was here. For a moment, I thought I had imagined it. But then it came again. Knock, knock, knock. Slow, methodical. My pulse quickened, and every instinct told me not to open that door. But curiosity, or perhaps something darker, drove me forward. I approached the door cautiously, the floor creaking beneath my hesitant steps. My hand trembled as I reached for the handle, and a cold sweat began to form on the back of my neck. The air around me felt thick, almost suffocating, as if the mansion itself was holding its breath. I swallowed hard and pulled the door open. There was no one there. The night was still and silent, the wind barely rustling the trees outside. The long driveway leading up to the mansion was empty, bathed in the pale light of the moon. For a moment, I let out a breath I hadn't realized I was holding. Maybe it had been a trick of the wind, a branch tapping against the door. Knock! This time it was louder, closer. I stepped back, my breath catching in my throat. The door was wide open, and yet the knock had come from inside. I turned slowly, my eyes scanning the darkened hallway behind me. The shadows seemed to move, shifting unnaturally, and the temperature dropped sharply, as if the very air around me had turned to ice. Knock, knock, knock. It was coming from the main hall now, from the grand staircase I had just descended. I could see the large, ornate doors at the base of the stairs trembling slightly, as if something, someone, was on the other side, waiting to be let in. I wanted to leave. I should have run then and there, but my feet felt rooted to the floor, as though some invisible force was holding me in place. Slowly, the doors creaked open just a crack. The air seemed to hum with energy, and a low, distant whisper filled the hall, though I couldn't make out the words. A figure stood in the doorway, shrouded in darkness. It was tall and gaunt, its form barely discernible in the gloom, but there was no mistaking its presence. My blood ran cold. I couldn't move. I couldn't breathe. The figure remained still, standing at the threshold of the hall, its face hidden in shadow. but I felt its eyes on me, watching, waiting. My mind raced, screaming at me to run, to get out of this place, but my body refused to obey. The whispering grew louder, more insistent. The figure didn't move, but I could feel its presence intensifying, pressing down on me like a weight I couldn't bear. I backed away slowly, my legs trembling beneath me. As I reached the door, I slammed it shut behind me, stumbling out into the cold night air. The mansion loomed behind me, dark and silent once again, as if nothing had happened. But I knew something was inside Briarwood Hall, something ancient, something that had been waiting, waiting for someone like me to open the door. I never went back after that night, and I've never spoken of it to anyone. But sometimes, late at night, when the house is quiet and the wind is still, I hear it again. Knock, knock, knock. And I know somewhere that ghost at the door is still waiting for me to return. Here's what another person said. The mansion's windows were dark and lifeless, like hollow eyes watching my every move. My heart pounded in my chest, my hand trembling as I reached for the door knocker. But before I could touch it, the door creaked open on its own, as if expecting me. I hesitated, an overwhelming sense of dread washing over me. Every instinct screamed to turn back, but curiosity, or perhaps something darker, drove me forward. I stepped inside, the floorboards groaning under my weight. The air was cold, unnaturally so, and the silence was oppressive, broken only by the faint whisper of wine through the cracks in the walls. As I ventured deeper into the mansion, the feeling of being watched intensified. It was as if the house itself was alive, breathing in my fear. I reached the grand hall, its once ornate furnishings now decayed and covered in dust. But something was off. The door at the far end of the hall? It was ajar. The uneasy silence was shattered by a sudden, hollow knock. My breath caught in my throat. The knock came again, louder this time, echoing through the empty halls. My legs felt like lead, but I couldn't stop myself from moving closer. With each step, the knocking grew more insistent, more impatient. As I reached the door, a gust of wind slammed it shut. My pulse raced, fear gripping me tighter with every second. I stood frozen, staring at the door, waiting for something, anything, to happen. And then, from the other side, came a low, guttural voice. It whispered my name, slowly, deliberately, as if savoring each syllable. I stumbled back, my mind racing to make sense of the impossible. I was alone, or at least I should have been. The voice came again, closer this time, as if whatever was on the other side of the door was right next to me, separated only by a thin barrier of wood. With shaking hands, I reached for the door handle. My fingers barely brushed the cold metal when the door swung open with a violent force. Standing in the doorway was a figure, pale, translucent, with eyes that seemed to pierce through the very fabric of reality. It was the ghost of a woman, regal in appearance, draped in tattered finery from a long-forgotten era. Her expression was one of sorrow and anger, as if she had been waiting for me, for anyone, for centuries. Before I could react, she raised her hand and pointed directly at me. The air grew colder still, and a deep, unnatural fear took hold of me. This wasn't just a ghost. It was something far more sinister, something that wanted me to know I was trespassing in a place I should never have entered. I ran. I didn't look back, didn't stop until I was far from the mansion's cursed grounds. But even now, I can still hear that knock, late at night, as if the ghost at the door is still waiting for me to return. Here's what a villager uncle said. I still remember the first time I saw the royal mansion. It was a dark, rainy evening when I drove up the long, winding road that led to the imposing estate. The mansion stood at the top of the hill, a hulking silhouette against the stormy sky, its tall, weather-beaten towers stretching into the clouds like skeletal fingers. Even in the dim light of the evening, I could feel its presence, ominous, cold, and watching. I had been invited by a distant relative, Lord Frederick, to spend a few days at the mansion to settle some family matters. Though we were barely acquainted, the family history intrigued me, and I couldn't resist the chance to explore the storied halls of the mansion. I'd heard the legends, of course. Everyone had. Whispers of ghosts, strange happenings, and a presence that was said to linger, especially near the grand front door. But I didn't believe in such things. Not then. When I arrived, Lord Frederick greeted me with a forced smile. His face seemed pale, his eyes tired, as though the mansion had drained something vital from him. I remember thinking he looked much older than I remembered. He led me into the grand foyer, the vast space echoing with the sound of our footsteps as we crossed the stone floor. The walls were lined with portraits of long-dead ancestors, their eyes following me as I passed, and the air smelled of age and dust. "This place has a lot of history," Frederick said, his voice low. "I hope you're comfortable with it." I nodded, though a shiver ran down my spine. As the evening wore on, the mansion's peculiarities began to show themselves. The old house creaked and groaned as the wind battered its walls, but that wasn't what unsettled me. It was the sense of being watched, like the house itself was alive, breathing, observing my every move. I dismissed it at first, chalking it up to nerves and the eerie ambience of the place. But the feeling only grew stronger as the night deepened. It wasn't until after dinner that Lord Frederick told me about the ghost at the door. We were sitting in the drawing room, the fire casting flickering shadows across the walls, when he began to speak, hesitant at first, but with a weight that made the room seem smaller. "You've probably heard about the hauntings," he said, staring into the flames. "But there's one spirit in particular that haunts this place. She appears only at the front door, always the front door." I felt a chill crawl up my spine, but I stayed silent, waiting for him to continue. "Her name was Lady Eleanor. She lived here centuries ago, back when the mansion was first built. They say she was madly in love with a nobleman, a man who promised to marry her. But on the eve of their wedding, he left, without a word, without reason. He never returned." Frederick's voice dropped, barely a whisper now. Lady Eleanor waited at the door for him, every night, until the night she died, standing by that very door, staring out into the rain, waiting for him to come back. The room seemed to grow colder with every word he spoke. "And now," he added, his voice strained, "some say she still waits. They've seen her, standing there in her tattered wedding dress, a ghostly figure at the door, knocking, hoping to be let in." I forced a laugh, trying to ease the tension in my chest. "Come on, Frederick. You don't really believe that, do you?" He didn't answer. He just looked at me, his expression grave. The fire popped and crackled in the hearth, but the room felt colder than ever. That night, I couldn't sleep. The storm raged outside, the wind howling as it lashed against the windows. I tossed and turned in the heavy, antique bed, the sheets feeling too cold against my skin. Every creak of the old house sounded like footsteps, every gust of wind like a whispering voice. Then, just after midnight, I heard it, a knock at the door. It was faint at first, so soft I thought I'd imagined it. But then it came again, louder this time. Three sharp, deliberate knocks. My heart raced. I sat up in bed, straining to hear through the storm. For a moment, all was silent. I thought maybe it had been the wind or some branch tapping against the side of the house. But then, there was again the unmistakable sound of someone knocking at the front door. I swallowed hard, my throat tight with fear. I told myself it was just some trick of the storm, some natural explanation. But deep down, I knew what it was. Lady Eleanor. I threw on my robe, my hands trembling as I crept out of my room and down the long, dark hallway. The house was eerily quiet, save for the occasional creak of old wood shifting. As I neared the grand staircase, I could hear it again, knock, 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 slow and steady, as though whoever was on the other side of the door had all the time in the world. The hairs on the back of my neck stood up, and my feet felt like lead as I descended the stairs. My breath came in shallow, rapid bursts as I reached the foyer. The front door loomed before me, massive and imposing, its old iron handle gleaming faintly in the dim light of the hallway chandelier. For a long moment, I stood frozen, staring at the door. The knocking had stopped, but I knew she was still out there, waiting. Against my better judgment, I stepped closer. My hand hovered over the doorknob, cold sweat trickling down my back. Every instinct screamed at me to turn around, to leave the door shut, to never open it. But I couldn't help myself. I twisted the knob and pulled the door open. The night air rushed in, cold and biting. Rain pelted the ground outside, and the wind whipped at the trees lining the driveway. But no one was there. The stone steps leading up to the door were empty, slick with rainwater, and the path beyond was deserted. I stood there for a moment, shivering in the cold, trying to convince myself it had all been my imagination. Just the storm, just an old house making strange sounds. But as I turned to close the door, my eyes caught something, movement, just at the edge of the steps. A pale figure stood in the darkness, her tattered white dress billowing in the wind, her face obscured by a veil. She was staring directly at me, though her eyes were hidden. I couldn't move, my legs locked in place, my breath frozen in my chest as I watched her slowly raise one hand and knock. Once, twice, three times on the door. I stumbled back, my heart pounding in my throat. She didn't move. She just stood there waiting. For what, I didn't know. But her presence was suffocating, oppressive, as though the very air around her was charged with something dark, something ancient. I slammed the door shut, my hands shaking violently, and bolted it for good measure. But even after the door was locked, I could still hear it, the faint, steady knock echoing in the hallway. That was the last time I ever set foot in the royal mansion. Even now, I can't forget the sound of that knock, or the pale figure in the rain. Lady Eleanor is still there, waiting at the door for someone who will never come back, waiting for someone, anyone, to let her in.